establish seventh district, which is Montgomery, Pulaski, Bowie.
Delegate Paul Kreezak for the 44th district, and that is the Mount Vernon and Lee magisterial districts of Jefferson County.
Good morning, Dolores McQuinn, and representing the seventh council district, which is Henrico County, eastern part of Henrico, north Chesterfield, and part of the city of Richmond.
And I'm Delegate Barry Knight, I'm the chairman of the subcommittee, and I represent the 81st district, which is southern Virginia Beach and southern Chesapeake. This subcommittee has a lot underneath its purview from Department of Corrections to the state police to Veterans Affairs to ABC. So we just have a large, large, over $2 billion go flow through this, specifically through this committee. I'd like to welcome everybody here today. Today we've got three presentations to give us a little bit better idea of some of the needs, some of the agencies that are under our purview. We do have a caucus today, so we're going to try to limit each presentation to about 10 minutes, and we'll take any questions or comments from the committee in here. So first up, we have Mr. Harold Clark. He's Director of the Department of Corrections.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. Thank you for providing us this opportunity to present some pertinent information to you about the governor's introduced budget and some other fiscal needs and interests of the UC. I will move you rather quickly, knowing that we have 10 minutes. And so I hope I do justice by whatever information that you need. Let's begin by taking a look at offender health care. The department requested $20.3 million in fiscal year 2019 and $25.2 in fiscal year 2020. The governor's introduced budget proposes to provide $17.8 million in 2019 and $24.2 million in 2020. By law, the DOC is required to provide adequate health care to incarcerated offenders. Fiscal year 2017, offender medical per capita cost was $6,554. And you see how this compares very well to state employees' health care costs and also some other national comparisons I'll make in a second. The state employees' cost was $8,868, and this does not include copay costs and over-the-counter medications. In 2015, 20.2% of the total DOC population was 50 years old or older, compared to 11.1% in 2006. Inmates 50 years and older represent 31% of the population receiving off-site care and 53% of off-site medical costs. Inmates tend to be in a worse health situation when compared to the general population, and so their issues are more pronounced and costs are more pronounced as well. This chart shows how we compare nationally for offender costs. Looking at California, for example, and Vermont, at the top of the chart at 19,000 plus and 13,007 respectively. And Virginia, which is positioned just above the 49th state median, and then Alabama and Louisiana on the bottom of the scale. Mental health, as you all know, has been a very serious issue within corrections. The governor's introduced budget provides 600,015 FTEs in fiscal year 2019 and 2.3 million and 36 FTEs in 2020. Addressing offenders with serious mental illness in extended restrictive housing is a national trend that has been led by the Department of Justice and the American Corrections Association. Approximately 27% of the offenders in the DOC require some type of mental health service. 850 have been identified as seriously mentally ill, and 100 of those SMI offenders are in restricted housing at any given time throughout their incarceration. The Secure Diversionary Treatment Program was developed to provide a pathway for SMI classified offenders to break the general population segregation cycle and receive appropriate mental health treatment services and programs based on a mental health evaluation and assessment. These are highly structured and secure. The SDTP meets the goal of public safety while providing more intensive programming to restrictive housing offenders assessed as SMI. It also meets the ACA standard of not placing an offender with such a designation in extended housing for more than 30 days at a particular time. The specialized SDTP program sites are located at the River North Correctional Center, the Marion Treatment Center, and at Walnut Ridge State Penitentiary, which is one of our high secure institutions. The issue of female bed capacity has been concerning to us for some time, and we are seeing a growth in the number of female offenders coming to the agency. The governor's budget provide three medical and mental health staff at the Central Virginia Field Unit for Women. This investment of $235,000 per year for three FTEs will allow the DOC to better utilize the existing female bed capacity. It will allow for placement of females with greater medical and mental health conditions. Currently, we do have some open spaces where we cannot place these females because we do not have that medical and mental health care available, and the governor's budget will provide for that. The Culpeper Correctional Center for Women will eventually be needed. That facility has a capacity of 505 separate units. It will require 255 staff to operate with a budget of $23.4 million annually. The state responsible out of compliance female offender population has grown considerably over the last few years. In December of 2013, there were 164 females out of compliance that were backed up in jails across the Commonwealth. In December of 2017, that number grew by over 200 to 375 females who are out of compliance in jails that we cannot accept within the DOC. And statistical data shows state responsible releases who serve their entire incarceration in a local or regional jail recidivates at a much higher rate than those who come in to the DOC and are able to receive the treatment and the program is provided to those offenders within the DOC. Taking a quick look at the issue of probation and parole officers' caseload. Community corrections caseloads have increased 15.8% since June 2013 to December of 17. Staffing levels supervising these cases has only increased 5% during that same period of time. The governor's introduced budget has provided $541,000 for 17 FTEs in 2019 and $1.8 million for 35 FTEs in 2020. Moving on to the community corrections alternative programs, which were formerly known as detention and diversion centers, which are a form of probation. The community corrections alternative program is a residential sentencing option for the circuit courts to divert probationers from incarceration. Programs were transformed in May of 2017 to offer evidence-based programming to reduce recidivism. There are five CCAP programs. There are the Harrisonburg CCAP, the Appalachian CCAP, the Stanford CCAP, Chesterfield CCAP, and the Cold Springs CCAP. And they all have slightly different responsibilities in terms of what they're going to focus on. Some are offering general programming treatment for the offenders, including academic educations and so forth. Others are focusing, like the Cold Springs unit, on treating offenders that have opioid addictions. And so that treatment is heavily funded for that. And since opening in May of 2017, 60% of accepted referrals have been for opiate treatments at Cold Springs, with a total acceptance over a period of time of 405 offenders who have gone through that program. The governor's introduced budget provides $439,000 in both streets.
I don't know if this came up.
I didn't do anything. I didn't do anything.
This is part of
The governor's introduced budget provides $439,000 in both fiscal year 2019 and 20 to offer one response, one step to address the crisis of opiate abuse amongst probationers at the Cold Springs CCAP. Programs offers residential beds that effectively target high-risk opiate abusing offenders, as I stated. And the treatment model provides approximately 300 hours of intensive evidence-based substance abuse programming in a residential model. And this level of intensity and duration is necessary to appropriately address this opioid epidemic that we're experiencing. The governor also introduced funds for one additional FTE for the Board of Corrections. You may all be familiar with the issue of deaths in custody, in jail, that has been highly publicized. We have one position currently, or the Board of Corrections have one position to do all of the review of deaths in custody. It was felt that a second was necessary, so the governor's budget includes funds for a second position to assist with those reviews. Ongoing operational challenges. We are experiencing difficulties with offender officer vacancies. As of December 2017, there were 736 vacant correctional officer positions across the DOC. Although the DOC makes every attempt to keep its security positions filled, the department must use savings generated from vacancy savings to cover a variety of initiatives that are not fully funded. Those initiatives that are not fully funded include things such as information technology costs within the department, utility costs at facilities, such as gasoline and leases, contractual increases in operations for our private prison in Lawrenceville is included in those costs as well. Security vacancies create situations where overtime must be used to fill these essential positions, again, which adds to that cost schedule. I want to touch on the issue of employee compensation, so we'll skip ahead in the face of time and move to slide 19 now, David. And this slide shows that we're having an issue with employee retention, and I think it's largely due, not solely, but largely due to compensation as well. And this chart shows you that our turnover rates, going back for the years 15, 16, 17, and 18, have been increasing in corrections at a faster rate or higher rate than for all of other state government. And taking a look at the classifications of correctional officer senior and probation officers, those two are our bigger drivers. And you can see for each fiscal year, those have gone up. And for a half of fiscal year 18, the numbers continue to keep on that trend as well. DOC has made many efforts over the years to recruit and retain correctional officers within the agency. For the third quarter of 2017, 565 correctional officers were hired. And for that same period of time, we lost 510 correctional officers. Next slide takes a look at the officers' salaries. And you can see that correctional officers and seniors, their starting salary is $30,484, and the average salary tops out at $35,393. And for probation officers, that salary is $36,731, and tops out at $41,742. And lastly, assuming a DOC employee is the sole income provider of a family of four, then 1,164 current employees would be eligible for food stamps based on that employee's current compensation. The group would include 698 correctional officers. The group will also include UOC employees in 33 additional positions or titles to include executive secretaries, fiscal technician, dental assistants, ground supervisors, personal assistant, food service operators, time competition specialists, and others. This causes employees to seek higher paying jobs with other employers, and thusly contributes to that turnover rate that we're experiencing, which is higher than the state rate in general and continues to increase. Mr. Chairman, thank you for indulging me. I'll be glad to answer any questions that you or your members may have.
Mr. Clark, it's pretty enlightening. I'll make an observation or two. One, the governor put in his budget to try to help you out this year as much as possible in inmate health. But it's $44 million, but he tied it to Medicaid expansion. And we don't know if that's going to happen or not. We certainly don't know if it's going to happen in the size or scope to get $44 million. So we've got a hole in the budget right now to try to plug for you. We know that you said there's 736 vacancies in there. That's a tough job that these folks do. And they do it for $30,500. So it's absolutely something this committee is going to look at to try to get these salaries up, because if you get the salaries up, hopefully we can give them a living wage and we can give these give you a little bit of incentive to hire some more employees. So we know that this committee is going to look at that. It is on our radar screen, and which you certainly highlighted here for us today.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And the issue of staff compensation is number one on my list of priorities, because for us to be effective, it includes, first of all, hiring the appropriate people, compensating them at the right levels, and being able to keep them. If we can do so, the state will be much better off for us having done so.
Any other questions for Mr. Clark? Okay, Mr. Clark, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
And next we'll have Travis Hill with ABC. And Travis, you know that I've seen this presentation a half a dozen times or more, and I'm going to see it in about 2 hours when you send it to General Laws. For I happen to be subcommittee chairman for ABC. And also, I was a little bit derelict in my duties, but I wanted to recognize our staff person that keeps the train on the tracks for us, David Reynolds. He's got the institutional knowledge. He gets us our information, and he tries to keep us on time. So, David, thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Travis So with Virginia ABC, and I've got a pretty substantial source document for you here, and I'll try to run through it as best I can in the time allotted to be respectful of that. So we'll jump right in on.
Hey, Mr. Hill, I thought at one time you got a different looking letter up there.
I do, yes, sir. As of January 15th, I was appointed the CEO of the Virginia Alcoholic Beverage Control Authority, which was stood up on January 15th of this year as the department transitions to the authority. So I'm very much honored to assume that position and looking forward to implementing the transition plan we put together. And if time allows, I can walk you all through some of that information as well. But you know, as I said, Virginia ABC created under 4.1 for the last 80-plus years. They were a department run by 3 full-time members. They're transitioning over to 5 part-time members, with the CEO being also appointed by the governor. But our mission remains the same. We are the sole retailer of spirits, and we also regulate the entire alcohol beverage industry. So, and we think we do a pretty good job of it. We won Best Control State in 2015. For all of the endeavors that we have, retail, enforcement, education, across the board. So what are some aspects of ABC, sole retailer of spirits? We set where we locate our stores, how the products we select, the pricing that we use, and then how we promote, and that generates the revenue that you all receive. So quick overview, $637 million operating expenses, have close to 4,000 employees, and our gross sales continue to grow. We are just at the doorstep of $1 billion for the coming by fiscal year. 370 stores. We're open 362 days a year, 4,000 distinct products, and a lot of inventory to sell. And that's our historical sales growth. As you can see, as we open new stores, our revenues continue to grow for the Commonwealth. As I said, we also have responsibility for enforcing alcohol beverage laws. That's our Bureau of Law Enforcement. 104 is wrong. We've got 88 sworn agents and then 22 civilian staff. So they regulate the licensed entities, investigate and enforce the regulatory laws. And we also have our own hearings division. So we also collect the tax through the excise tax, the wine tax, beer excise tax. And this is our report to the Appropriations Committee. This is our contribution to the Commonwealth over the last five, six fiscal years as it continues to grow in that respect. So our forecasts, we have the revenue side as well as the spend side for you all. We're projecting a growth of 4.42%, which is a little bit higher than current industry projections. But we are, we're highly weather dependent, highly calendar dependent. So weather like we've experienced these last few weeks does close some of our stores. It will impact some of our sales and that some of those sales are lost. But we continue to track fairly well across the calendar at this point. We are saving some money in cost of goods sold. We think that's because people are trading up in product, and so our margin's a little bit bigger in that regard. So some of the expenses we have in 18 going forward, we pay our own pay increases for staff as they're increased. We also cover the healthcare costs as well as paying for new store positions and that sort of thing. Depreciation, I wanted to touch on this really quickly because we are, while the state is a cash accounting entity, we are required to follow GAAP, so we depreciate our assets. So when you see a budget request from us that we capitalize, it's not a single hit on cash. It stretches out over time as we depreciate that asset. So, and this is our financial forecast for the next few years. As you can see, bottom line, net profit, we continue to project to grow. There is a dip that we project in 2021, and that's based on a lot of the projects that we're currently working on starting to be depreciated across the board. But we do project continuing to grow revenues for the foreseeable future. So operating budget submissions, a number of items that I'll get into. The top one, cost of goods sold, that's about the products we have to purchase in order to sell them. So we kind of need that money to buy the products to put them on the store shelves going forward. But that is the list of items that we've put forward, and I can talk about each one independently. The point of sales audit, those are the cash registers. Those are those devices that take your credit card, that ring out the sale, and we've got to replace those generally about every 10 years. We've got over 1,000 lanes of POS equipment, so think of a sales lane. And we're going to be end of life with that entire system in about 2 years. The prospect of not replacing these systems means we are going to see higher failure rates. We're going to be slower to open new stores, primarily because a lot of this equipment is no longer being manufactured. We were able to acquire 25 store servers from a third-party salvager. So this equipment is becoming harder and harder to find. We also have security issues once this equipment's no longer supported because we won't be getting the patches and the support that we need. Also, the benefit for point of sale?
Yes, sir. There's a question real quick.
Yeah, real quick, Travis.
Yes, sir.
Excuse me. I don't mean to interrupt, but under the new authority, how the authority is set up, can you start planning for these in the future where you can set aside monies? Or does that still come through the general assembly?
It'll still come through the general assembly in terms of project approvals and that sort of thing. What we are trying to do a better job of is planning and letting you all know what's coming down the pipe. When I first got here in 2015 and I presented all of our needs, I think I took a lot of people by surprise because we hadn't been presenting that. And it's a big dollar figure. And so we're trying to do a better job of communicating these needs coming forward so that we can plan for it, just as you saw with that profit forecast, you can understand the money that's going to be coming to the general fund well into the future. So the other benefit of a modern POS is some of the things that you're seeing with other retailers, the multi-channel sales, e-commerce, being able to do things online more seamlessly, real-time inventory. So when you look on our website, you can know that's the number of bottles we have in stock, as well as customer programs, loyalty programs, coupons, those types of things. Our email SharePoint transition. This is really kind of the first decision made under the authority model. The Commonwealth is going to Google Gmail. However, when we've done our analysis, it's better for ABC to go with Office 365 from a business standpoint. A lot of our systems are already within the Microsoft suite, and it's going to be easier for us to transition and keep a lot of these services. We don't see this over the long term. We see this probably saving us money through the operation of the system. It allows us to consolidate operations as well as have some access to technologies for future projects. The positions for new and high-performing stores, about a third of our revenue growth is attributable to new stores. We generally open about 8 every year. When you open a new store, you have to have positions to staff that store. So that's what this is about. We also have store growth. So some of our stores, as they grow, higher customer counts, more transactions, we need more employees to staff those stores to deal with those customer counts and the volume of sales going through it. So we forecast that out and then put in a request for those positions to staff those stores. We're also working on transitioning some part-time positions to full-time. And what this is about, the 29-hour rule that was adopted under the Affordable Care Act had a huge impact on us because we used a lot of part-time employees who worked a full 40-hour week. We just didn't pay them benefits. When we were limited to 29 hours, we hired an additional almost 600 folks to cover those additional hours. What we're seeing is extremely high turnover within our waiting population, close to 50%. That has a tremendous impact on customer service. It also has a huge impact on the training costs. It costs about $500, we think, to train an employee. We'll hire around 1,000 in a year. We'll lose 500 of those folks. So that's just money that walks out the door every time we lose those folks. Last biennium, you all did approve a growth of the full-time positions by 50, and we're having great success with that. Out of those 50 positions, only 4 have left the organization, and we've actually promoted 8. So we think that's a great benefit. We wouldn't look to replace all of these part-time positions with full-time. There comes a point where you've got that proper mix, but we think there's still room to do something like this just based on the turnover that we're seeing and the difficulty to staff our stores. Also, within the enforcement activities, we conducted a license fee study during the past year, and we really found that the fees that we're generating are not covering the cost to enforce the alcohol laws of the Commonwealth. And so we've got a proposal in to increase some application fees as well as some direct shipping fees to help cover some of these costs. What we would do with that money, we would fund agent positions, because what we've got the agent positions, they're just not funded anymore. We've had to pull that money away. And so we're looking at hiring additional agents as well as non-sworn personnel that can help to specifically focus on a couple of the laws that we think need greater emphasis moving forward. This is going to be an effort that's going to continue in 2018, working with our stakeholder groups to assess fees across the board that haven't been revisited in quite some time to support enforcement services. The capital needs, also before your all's capital outlay subcommittee, is language for ABC's new warehouse and central office. We continue to work with DGS to narrow our choices and scope the project properly so that you all can make an informed appropriation decision on that effort. Also, to Delegate Rush's question, we do have an IT modernization program in place that was started in 2015. These are all our major systems. Anything in blue is beyond the expected life. You can see we are at a tremendous deficit with our systems. These are the central systems, warehouse management, warehouse material handling, finance, which we have a project stood up now, but this is kind of the menu that we have to choose from when we're looking at replacing our systems. The funded projects, financial management system, we hope to have a contract signed this summer. Licensing is underway. We're going to complete website in the spring, and then broadband has been completed, and then the electrical system for our central office was deferred until we figure out what we're going to do with the central office facility. These are our future IT projects, some additional website enhancements, identity management, warehouse management, inventory management, which is tied to that building decision, and then also looking at tax management, human resources, payroll, and trying to add functionality as well as just additional security enhancements and stability. Give you an outlook on private sector, how that's impacting us. Tremendous growth in breweries, spirits, wine. I see that as an opportunity, not a nightmare. I think that we have a great opportunity in terms of economic development, growing revenue, but we also have to handle a lot of these new entrants into the industry. It'll explain the laws, regulate, and it restrains or places a great burden on our enforcement capabilities. Also, direct shipping, which is one of the fees that we're asking to increase. Tremendous. This is direct to consumer. This is the trend now in almost all retail. Alcohol is not exempt from that, where we are seeing more folks receiving products directly from shippers. We were one of the first to permit this activity, and we have had a tremendous amount of growth in this regard. You can see the number of just wine meters being direct shipped to Virginians. You have to have a shipper's license in order to ship into Virginia. What we are finding is we get common carrier reports on what's coming into the state. A tremendous amount of wine is coming in unlicensed. And we have to figure out how to reach out to these out-of-state entities, get them to pay the wine tax, that's what you all care about, the revenue, but then also being able to track the wine coming into the state, understanding how that's moving through. So that's the money equation there, is what are we collecting on wine taxes on this direct shipping. I'm out of time, but I'll give you a quick authority transition, key aspects, part-time board, appointed CEO. We are exempt from the Personnel Act, Procurement Act, and VITA. Stood up a number of work streams to move through the analysis and transition to the authority. Some of the major changes on the personnel, employees are moving from classified to at will. We're changing the leave program so that it is a paid time off situation. There's also opportunities for pay for performance. Procurement, we're looking to have greater negotiations when we procure. Also, we're exempt from mandatory sourcing. These are all the work streams that we stood up in order to transition to the authority. These were staffed by employees within the agency, and it has everything to do with documentation. Where do we change our name, our letterhead, our business cards, our badges, HR policies, changing the hearings process to accommodate a part-time board, all of those things that kind of go into running the organization. This is the current organization of the ABC Authority. The department board will exist until June 30th of this year, so there's an overlap on the five-member board, so you have the department and the authority represented, the CEO, and then C-suites. So right now, when I was the chief operating officer, I had about 12 direct reports, so that is narrowing that down and getting better focus into each area of these responsibilities. And then in July, it will be all authority board members, same work structure under that. And the biggest impact or effort that we'll have this year is transitioning all of our employees into the authority. We're going to be doing it in waves. Our wage employees will be transitioned by the end of March. Then we'll have logistics and retail transition in August, doing that ahead of the busy season of October, November, December. Then we'll do central office in October and then enforcement at the end to accommodate their extended recruitment period. So that's the biggest plan there. That's it.
We thank you on that. We know that we worked hard for a few years on the authority legislation. We had a delayed enactment on it, so I know that, and we've actually tweaked it a couple of times the last couple of years to try to make a smooth transition. And you don't have the critical needs that, say, the Department of Corrections does, but for lack of a better term, you're a cash cow for the state.
Yes,
I mean, because we have a monopoly here. Let's just recognize that. So if we have to spend $1,000 to return on investment, get us $4,000 back, that's what we're looking at. We're going to have to spend money to make money. We also, I knew years ago when I went to your facility, probably about the time you got there, maybe before you got there, they were doing everything in manila folders there. They didn't have a computer system over there. Our cell phones had more computer space than they did. So they're trying to transition slowly. It's hard for us to spend money. But it's been good working with you.
I'd love to talk to you offline, but I have lots of questions about like how you handle getting your product from the warehouse to the stores, whether or not you've got, during certain peak times, you can't sell certain direct shipping, we don't do that though, right?
We do not. I think we have the legal capability to do it. Quite frankly, it's the technical that's holding us back. Things like real-time inventory, you don't want to allow someone to order something online that's not really in the warehouse. That leads to a bad experience. And so it's being able to have that capability to fill those orders. But I think that delivery is something that consumers are continuing to expect all across the product spectrum. I don't think alcohol is immune to that. I think we, as a retailer, have to figure out how to meet that consumer's need and do it responsibly and quickly. You referenced stockouts. That's a big conversation piece over the holidays because it's a ton of volume that we do. There are times when we are out of stock. Sometimes that's our fault for forecasting. A lot of times it's the supplier who's not getting enough into the warehouse. But it's all about how do we get it quickly into our warehouse, processed, back out on the truck and into the store.
In the past, Appropriations Committee and General Laws Committee has toured their warehouse, toured and everything. And I'm sure that he would be open to doing that as a committee in the future. But if you have a real need to see it in the interim, and you pull yourself away, I'm sure they'd give you a real quick tour.
We're right off of 95. As you're driving north and you pull off, we'll have you in there.
Delegate McQuinn.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Travis, I think that there was some challenges in terms of part-time employees, but you're moving in the direction of trying to hire for full-time employment. What would be your starting salary for a full-time employee, I guess wage employee?
Wage employee, I think it's close to $12 an hour. It's like a little under $12, it's 11. I'll go and check that to double, to make sure I'm sure that's the right number, but I think we're in that neighborhood.
Okay, and how soon would that employee making $12 an hour move up to receive a higher?
Mm-hmm. When they're salaried, I don't know what our starting salary is. I think it's low 20s into the clerk position.
You make a lot of money, but never mind.
I know where you're going on
right.
That. And one of the things we're looking at with the authority is a pay-for-performance model, because we will have that release at the end of the year that says we just set record profits. And I'll get a few emails from store employees that say, I'm not getting any of that. And so being able to reward sales behavior, responsible sales behavior, is something that we're interested in figuring out in the future.
Thank you, Travis. That's why we transitioned to an authority to give us more tools in our toolbox.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next, we're going to have an overview from the Department of State Police. And that's a brand new Colonel Gary Settle. Welcome, sir. We're glad to have you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I will note that while he's getting ready to get up there, the state police were woefully underpaid for years and years, and they just really bit the bullet for us when we were in our downturn in the recession. But we were able to find, and he'll tell us, I'm sure, somewhere in the neighborhood of about $6,700 per officer raise. And I would certainly hope that helped you with retention.
That must be seen. That must be seen.
course.
Is it on the laptop page?
It is on the presentation. It is on the laptop.
The opportunity to talk about our agency real briefly here. First of all, I'd like to say thank you for that salary increase last year. It was in the neighborhood of $6,700. It's greatly appreciated, and we extend that to the legislators. I will tell you that $6,700 translated into hope for some of our folks. And we typically have, from that 3 to 6 year period, tenure. Those folks are leaving the agency to go to other law enforcement agencies that are paying higher salaries, and or some go to the private sector as well. But that raise last year certainly helped stop that leakage a little bit, and I'll talk about that here shortly. We also like to thank you for the support of our Special Operations Division last year. We have one full-time tax team now in that division, and that's going to certainly prove to pay dividends in the future. Those folks on the tax team, even when they weren't full-time, they were full-time. Those were folks that are troopers and pulled off the road for to respond to some of these tactical calls. Last year in 2017, I'll tell you, was some of our major events. We lost three of our own last year. Special Agent Mike Walter, you may recall that, Trooper Burke Bates and Lieutenant Jay Cullen. We had our malware attack in April of last year. We're still vulnerable from that malware attack. Some things in place to take care of that. We're still working very hard with you to try to resolve that. We have numerous civil disturbances last year that we responded to with our tactical field force. 93, you can figure the math. And some of those were upwards of 200 or 300 people, 600 or so at Charlottesville, some 40 or 50 depending on the event. Nevertheless, those are folks that are being pulled off the road for traffic safety or some of the other things that we do. Heard of the Atlantic Coast Pipeline, the Mountain Valley Pipeline, and we started preparing that in August. We spoke with the Dakotas, DAPL, if you will, regarding their experience.
We've got some help coming to all of us around here.
Excuse us.
Sorry. We have a young person to help us.
Initiation. So, I'll talk about the salary increase. in this part of the operations division. Thank you for that. And you'll see here, I was talking about the civil disturbances last year, 93 in total, planning for the Atlantic Coast Pipeline. That's where I stopped at. That's a huge project. You all are aware, probably, that project was supposed to have been done in 2017 in the early stages of 2018 because of process that's been moved up. That'll be resource intense with state police with regards to potential protests, ingress, egress, nefarious activity going on across the state. So we'll have a robust footprint and planning for that is going on, continue to go on. For agency priorities, I won't believe we each other, but all these are very important to us. Talk a little bit about the agency update with regards to our sworn allocation and our civilian allocation with regards to resources. 2991 total, that's civilian and sworn. In 2016, we had 157 separations. In 2017, 147 separations. That's huge for us. And I don't know, it's too early in the process, and I'm sure $6,700 has helped with that. But the reality of it is, we still have 349 vacancies, 270 of those being sworn. Keep in mind, our civilian support staff are equally as important. The resiliency of these folks are unbelievable. It's extraordinary. The 217, we lost 10 in January, just up to this point right now. So I don't know if that's a trend. If that's a trend, that's a lot in January, but we'll see. The compensation continues to be a challenge. Other agencies have also increased their salaries, so we're going to be faced with some of the same issues. Our problem is with compression, and until we get a sustained funding and take care of the compression, we're always going to have these folks that are looking to go to other agencies to pay. I've talked about 3 to 6 year trooper due to the inability to support retention salary steps. That's the compression. That's typically the tenure category that we usually use for troops. Approved legislation. Real quickly, the e-summons. Delegate President, we appreciate the efforts on that. It speaks for itself. This is a safety issue. Enhances our officer safety and also efficiency in the courts and those certify the courts with the e-summons. There are a number of agencies that are doing that now, and the courts that are compatible with doing that certainly will be very beneficial to our agency. The prescription monitoring, this just changes the definition of receiver. There's some criminal activity that we have detected with regards to a third party coming in, picking up a diverged pharmaceutical product, and it's for nefarious means of criminal activity. We need to get those folks in the prescription monitoring program because that's a robust program that helps us with our criminal investigations. Proposed budgets items providing funding for 2 helicopters. One of these helicopters just at the end of shelf life, if you will. The other one is due to a crash in Charlottesville on August 12th. Next item is provides partial funding for Comlink, if you will. This is a multi-jurisdiction radio interoperability, if you will. So and that needs an influx of money as well to continue that. If you could just imagine our umbrella, everything under that umbrella, agencies that are affiliated with Comlink, we need that continued funding in case there's a statewide emergency. The next item is to provide continued funding to the CCH. We've worked on the core part of our CCH database, if you will, but there's some other exterior things that need to be also looked at and updated. Provides for 10 FTEs for the Special Operations Division. This will be our second full-time TAC team that will come on board. We have 7 divisions. If you don't know, there's a TAC team in each one of those, so ultimately, it'll be 7 attack teams as part of that Special Operations Division. 4 FTEs for the Virginia Fusion Center. The Virginia Fusion Center provides support in many different ways. Intel, case support, threat assessment, cybercrime, the heroin initiative, and critical infrastructure. We have analysts that are specialized in all those areas. Everything we do, an analyst touches us operationally, and it's just part of the program. So when you send a trooper or a special agent, you send an analyst. They're very, very important to our operational program. Two FTEs for the polygraph control program. If you're not aware, there's a polygraph law enforcement accreditation. There's only 13 agencies in the country that are accredited. We are one of those. In fact, Virginia is being used as a model for the program that we put together last year to go to other state agencies. In the budget, it also is planning funds for the training academy. And you can see the House bill set bills for the to provide planning funding, and this is for infrastructure. Our training academy is crumbling in front of us. Also in the AI budget is a two-year pay raise for year two. The next item I'll skip over, I understand that's been tabled, so in best interest of time. And the next item, VSPNet. This is for the VSIN in our localities, and we manage that through our general budget, and we are proposed a bill to manage services to independently support that VSP. Current is not in the proposed budget. It does not provide us STARS funding. We're at the end of life technology with STARS. It's not, I don't want to alarm you, it's not broken and going to fall down tomorrow, but technology has we're always chasing technology. And in this case here with STARS, we need money to update the technology with that program so we can continue to have a robust radio system. Removes $2.9 million allocated to IT security gaps. As you all know, we're still, I talked about the malware issue back early last year. We're still working through that with VITA. There's an assessment study going on. A third of that study has been completed. Colonel Marlowe and myself went to a meeting last week and got the update on that. There's two-thirds of it still out there. A lot of this will talk about transformation and need to or not. So we're trying to identify that we're still very vulnerable at this point in our current situation. Proposed budget not to provide funding for civil disturbance packets, if you will, our tactical field force. Right now we have a number of tactical field force troopers that respond to these civil disturbances. Our goal is to train all of our troopers as they come out of the academy so we can have even more to replace some of the ones who are at the end of their career getting ready to retire. And also because of the environment and the number of protests and disturbances that we respond to, doesn't provide for the tactical field force protective equipment, if you will, I call them the turtle suits, most folks understand that, but there's equipment associated with that, and communications. And also five FTEs for command and management, and a lot of this has to do with the logistics. So it takes that burden off of our folks in the field where they can concentrate operationally on the assignment. No funding for the agency-wide billing system. I heard some agency talking about their folders and having papers, and we're much like that in a lot of ways. In our agency, we need funding for automation, and one of those is the agency-wide building system. Our basic schools, real quickly, the 127th is in session right now. We hope to graduate 54 students on May the 11th. And our next school is 128 scheduled to start on April 26th. We'll graduate in June. And then in 2018 also, it's the 129th set to begin in July. They won't graduate until February of 2019. 130 not yet scheduled. So this will be the first year we've graduated two schools in 1 year. So and not knowing how many will be in the 128th, yet to be seen, they'll provide some relief to us with regards to our vacancy rate. In closing, obviously, our organization, the state police, our agency is always looking for better ways to collaborate with other law enforcement across
job you do, and I know you just got in the job and we've got confidence in you, but please pass on from the committee. We appreciate what all your ladies and gentlemen do for us to keep us safe here. Any questions?
Yeah, Caroline, I don't know if you have the information now, but you have the makeup on gender, racial, and age makeup of your force.
I do not have that with me, but we do have that information. I certainly did that too.
Thank you. I would appreciate that.
Okay.
Thank
you. Okay. Well, right on time. Thank you, sir. Okay. Meeting's adjourned.
Oh.